in this edition of Art Loft, a painter with a knack for island scenes.
I paint landscapes for the simplicity and the color, the atmosphere. I'm attracted to the Florida landscape, the bright colors, the pastel colors.
Florida Keys or Bust, a history of tourism.
It's wonderful because we have locals come in who I think don't even fully appreciate how far back the tourism industry extends, you know, in the Florida Keys. And so they've come in and learned something and taken that away with them.
Mental illness through the eyes of an artist.
What we did was we took those answers and Michael associated them with different eyes to keep the anonymity going.
Mario Sanchez, where Cuba and Key West unite.
He's the most important Cuban-American folk artist of the 20th century and the very first native Floridian to have a museum exhibit in New York.
And we view painter Edward Hopper through a New York lens.
It sets up a kind of voyeuristic tension that Hopper exploited over and over again.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from History Miami, this is Art Loft. Welcome to Art Loft. Tonight, we take a closer look at the artwork and creative process behind some well-known Edward Hopper paintings. But first, meet John Hover, an artist from the northern region of the Florida Keys in Isla Mirada. His paintings depict the lush landscapes and island scenes that surround his home. Take a look.
I work in oil and I work in pastels. I paint with an underpainting, and what I do is I paint with basically the opposite colors that I'm going to end up with. Kind of makes a nice vibration. I work with paper and then I use a brush and I smear the pastel with water so it kind of turns into like a watercolor. And then I draw and paint and I work back into that with gesso. So that's a freer, faster way of working than oil. Oil paint is a little more formal. You paint a day and then you wait a couple days and then you paint another day. Pastels, you only have to wait a couple hours. I paint landscapes for the simplicity and the color, the atmosphere. I'm attracted to the Florida landscape, the bright colors, the pastel colors. It's a funny thing. I go up north in the summertime and I think about doing landscapes, but I've seen so many northern landscapes, I just am not attracted to painting that way. If I grew up north, I would probably paint people. I rarely paint man-made objects. Occasionally there's a channel marker or there's a bridge. The old 7 Mile Bridge has some nice arches and I use that. But normally I get rid of anything man-made. I kayak a lot, so when I go out into the wilderness, I take a camera and I sketch with a camera, basically. So I'm attracted to places where there aren't any people. And if I paint, say, a beach, I get rid of the houses. I made the Keys my home because of the wonderful color and the serenity. It's just this, and my paintings are very simplistic. They're minimalistic, you would say. And it's just water and sky and a horizon. And we got lots of that here. To have my work displayed in public places is a great honor. I have several projects that I've done for art in public places. a lot in the Keys, and two in Broward County and one in Dade County, actually. The most public and the biggest piece I've done, and I'm probably proudest of, would be the piece in the Murray Nelson Government Center. It's 10 feet high and 8 feet wide. It's a vertical, and it's coming down a creek and coming out into the bay. And you can see the bay and the bright sunshine of the bay. And then you got all these dark, dramatic colors of the tunnel. Well, I've photographed in that area several times. Once my family and I were in a boat and I took a kayak. We had a kayak with us and I took a kayak into the bushes and photographed. And that was a great day because my grandkids were with me, and I'll always remember that day. I've been starting to do these collages, and I've been taking scrap prints on canvas, pasting them together and making new images. So they're kind of abstract images made from realistic images. When you're successful, it's a bit of a problem because people are expecting you to do the same thing over and over again. So, and that's what people want. And so it always becomes a problem with an artist because we always want to keep growing. So it's a tough thing. I mean, I'm at a point in my life where I'm pushing ahead, and it doesn't really matter if it's commercially successful or not. I can't describe it. You know, it creeps up on you. You just work, and your work changes, but you don't really mean it to. You know, I mean, it just happens. And I guess you could call that growth.
To connect with this artist, log on to johndavidhaver.com. And for the ultimate in art and culture throughout the Florida Keys, visit fla-keys.com.
We created the eyes, and then in the second part is the medicine cabinets. And we realized in the medicine cabinets, why not put the medication they take?
For decades, the Florida Keys have been described as a tropical exotic paradise, attracting visitors from around the country and abroad. For this story, we journeyed to the southern end of this island community, to Key West, and got a glimpse at the history of its tourism industry.
Florida Keys or Bust, a history of Key West. What we wanted to do is tell the story of tourism and how this island has developed over the past 190 years or so. It starts as soon as the island is founded in 1821 and goes right up through the present day. After the Great Depression, the WPA artists moved down here and started boosting tourism as much as they could to promote the island because the island had gone bankrupt. They were part of the Federal Emergency Relief Act that brought artists down to Key West and other cities all around the country. It wasn't just to Key West. And they were meant to exemplify the city through their paintings and their etchings to make people want to come here to basically form an industry out of nothing. And from that time on, tourism had a significant impact on the economy. There was a substantial boom in tourism right after the opening of the railroad. In the exhibition, we have some artifacts from Flagler's Railroad, so some of the signal lights. We also have a lantern that the conductors would use, and also sections of track and some wood from the actual carriages. I think that the interesting part about using postcards and brochures in the exhibit is essentially everybody can recognize those. And it also epitomizes, I think, the tourism experience. You know, now with things like Facebook and Instagram, it's not as prevalent, but you know, 15 years ago, that was the way to demonstrate to your friends and family the experiences you were having on your vacation. The postcards are all in our permanent collection here at the museum, and we just scanned them in and blew them up so people can really appreciate the true artistic nature of them because they really are quite colorful and very beautiful. The postcard collection is somewhere in the realm of 3,000, so it was actually really difficult to even pick the ones that we put out. So we try to target things that people would identify with coming down here, Hemingway and the aquarium, or people come down here to go fishing, so we tried to use some fishing motif involved in here as well. It's wonderful because we have locals come in who I think don't even fully appreciate how far back the tourism industry extends, you know, in the Florida Keys. And so they've come in and learned something and taken that away with them. We have a lot of tourists that come into our museum, and I think that they get a better understanding of how tourism developed and why are they here as opposed to going somewhere else on their vacation. Part of the tourism industry down here involved a lot of businesses, and one of those businesses was called Key West Handprint Factory. People that were down here tourists between the 60s and early 2000s went to Key West Handprint Factory. So these are some of the examples of the items that they fabricated. Also in the 1970s, the island had gone through a bit of a lull in the economy, and we had a big influence of gay business owners moving down here and opening businesses and buying up all the property and fixing it up so it actually, you know, beautified the city, and then there were things to draw people to the island which hadn't been there.
Out to sea in an automobile on a road through the Atlantic Ocean.
We were very fortunate to stumble across a commercial produced by Chevrolet in the 1930s, before the hurricane, so I think it was probably about 1934. And the commercial focused on the new Chevrolet model that was available for that particular year and how comfortable and smooth of a ride it is. And because the road was in the process of being built to come down to the Keys, they thought it was a great marketing option for them to say to drive down. Typically, you had to take a ferry between two keys, the road would stop, you'd hop on a ferry with your car, continue on, and then get back on a road and go. And what Chevrolet was hoping to achieve was saying their ride was so comfortable that you couldn't forget using the ferry. You can actually just drive over the train tracks instead and you wouldn't feel any of the bumps because it was such a smooth ride. So you can forego the unfortunate ferry ride. I think actually one of the most endearing things that we have in the exhibit is focusing on the southernmost point. That's always a place that tourists go. They love to get their photographs taken. There's currently a giant buoy painted at the southernmost point, but that hasn't been there that long. Before the southernmost buoy was actually put there, there was a gentleman, Mr. Key, who used to sit there with his family every day selling conch shells and all sorts of wonderful little items for people to buy just underneath a sign. The thing I would like visitors to take away, I think, is the rich history that the Florida Keys has. And we use tourism as an example, but there are a lot of other elements that are incorporated into the exhibit that I think it fleshes it out a little. You know, we're talking about the railroad, we're talking about the Great Depression, we're talking about industry down here that drove tourism. So I think by using tourism at the center, we're hoping that visitors, both local and from afar, can come down here and appreciate the rich history that we have down here.
The Key West Art and Historical Society features three distinct national landmarks, each with its own exhibits. To learn more, enter kwahs.org and stay up to date on events taking place throughout this island chain by following them on Twitter, at the Florida Keys.
With his work, you can see history, you can see Key West, you can see the old Key West.
Just a few blocks away from the Customs House on Front Street, you'll find the studios of Key West. Here, Michael Phillips's photographs and site-specific installation offer a new perspective on mental illness. This story keeps us in the southern tip of the Florida Keys. Take a peek.
My name is Sherry Reed, and I am the president of Heron Peacock Supported Living, which is an assisted living facility for adults with mental illness. And I wrote a grant to the Florida Keys Arts Council to do this art and social cause installation. It's called Without a Face, Looking into the Eyes of Mental Illness. And this is to use the arts as a way to bring a subject to light, to raise awareness on a very taboo subject that most people don't think about or talk about.
My name is Michael Phillip, and I'm an architectural photographer. We interviewed residents of the Heron Peacock House, and we asked them, where's the first place that they see their eyes? And they said, well, in the medicine cabinets in the bathroom. And that's how we started the conversation going. So we created the eyes, and then in the second part, it's the medicine cabinets. And we realized in the medicine cabinets, why not put the medication they take? And we found the creative ways of showing them education. So we have the meds that they take, the effects, and the side effects. So this is what I take to smile in the morning. This is what I take to sleep. But I could lose my hair or I can gain weight. So the viewer starts identifying with these people and starts to realize that they are practically, the you and the I is the same.
The most wonderful thing about this is the eyes, because the eyes are the most informative piece about the body and actually create the most connection with other people when we look into their eyes. He immediately got it and said, let's do it. While Michael was photographing the people, he was asking them questions like, so what is it that you do in the morning? What's the first thing that you do when you wake up? What's the color of your toothbrush? What's in your medicine cabinet? And while they were giving us the answers, I was writing them down on a piece of paper. And so what we did was we took those answers and Michael associated them with different eyes. To keep the anonymity going.
The people who we used were the residents, but really what we want to target is everybody to create the awareness. And tonight we're realizing that this many people that are here had no clue that these organizations exist. And that's one of the things that Sherry has been doing for years, because all the other organizations that deal with different subjects have more like sex appeal. So for some reason, mental health does not. Doing an art show was to give it a little sex appeal.
To view more photos from this artist, log on to michaelphillip.com. And for details on exhibits and other events at the studios of Key West, enter tskw.org.
And it sets up a kind of voyeuristic tension that Hopper exploited over and over again.
The Mario Sanchez One Race, the Human Race project in Key West showcases select pieces created by the late artist of the same name. This summer, we sat down with the exhibit's U.S. curator to learn about Sanchez and his connection to today's contemporary artists.
Working with the most important Native Floridian artist, Mario Sanchez, for 20 years now. And 20 years ago, we started talking about his philosophy of life, which was one race, the human race, gender, racial, and religious equality, which is the basis and the fundamental part and the history of Key West. Key West is different from anywhere else you've ever been in your whole life. Key West, for 150 years, has embraced diversity. Mario Sanchez was born in 1908.
He's a folk artist from Key West. He comes from a Cuban family that came many, many years ago to Key West.
His grandparents came here during the 10-year war in Cuba, which the Cuban people lost against Spain. And they had to come to Key West because they were political refugees. He's the most important Cuban-American folk artist of the 20th century and the very first Native Floridian to have a museum exhibit in New York.
Something I love about Mario is the naive and the simplicity in his work. When I see Mario Sanchez's work, it reminds me from my childhood.
It all started out with an exhibit for Mario at the National Gallery in Havana.
And for me, that was the most wonderful experience. They had like 30 works there. With his work, you can see history, you can see Key West, you can see the old Key West. But I think for a Cuban who knows a little bit about history, when you see Mario Sanchez's work, it's like you have a reach of images from histories you have been hearing your life.
As we started developing with my co-curator, Hortensia Montero, from the National Museum of Fine Art in Havana, we started talking about doing an exchange. So we chose artists who were old and young, black and white and Hispanic, of course. We chose artists with different religions and different genders. So all of those people came and it was all about the art.
So that was the principal idea, bring different people with different ideas and also with the past in common, Key West. They did a big exhibition all around the city, different galleries, different places.
This was the largest group of Cuban artists who had ever worked together in the United States.
Different religions, colors, races. We don't care. When we have a common passion, we are all the same. We go in the same direction. And that's a wonderful experience. When you have this common passion, you don't see who is by your side, because everyone wants the same thing, same path, same way. I work with a group of artists who have been working together 3.5 years. It's called Stainless. It's based in Havana, Cuba. This painting over here is the sketch for the giant installation, of course. This sketch, it would be really difficult to build this because they are really falling from the sky into a sea. That black one over there is from a theory we call Death of a Process. Our first painting we wanted to do, traditional way of painting with oils on canvas in a contemporary world with a contemporary vision. And I remember we had this drawing. It was like a drawing from a cave. At the very beginning, we wanted to paint it like a normal painting. So we said, no, we won't paint more like normal. Let's try and do this like a real cake, like using pastry devices. So we contracted a person who makes real cake. She came into the studio and then she started doing this. So simple. After 30 minutes, she was out and was doing big giant cakes.
This is about taking Mario Sanchez's idea of one race, the human race, and making it function, building that cultural bridge to Cuba with the United States and every other country, really, is what this is all about. You know, Key West is known for a lot of things, key lime pie and conch fritters, but what's really exceptional about Key West is that we've had 150 years of embracing diversity, because we want to know who you are, not how much money you have or what you do. And that's what Mario was all about.
Whoever who comes and visits the exhibition, see the artists in the exhibition involved in this project, they will get a total mixture of ideas, culture, history, and people from everywhere. It's one race, same.
To learn more about this project, visit galleryongreen.com. And to see more folk art from Sanchez, visit the Fort East Martello Museum in Key West. Details at kwahs.org.
Not until I was 11 or 12 did I begin to understand that this was something quite unique that she was doing.
Finally tonight, we take an intimate look at the life and work of artist Edward Hopper from the city that shaped and informed his distinctive style. Join us in New York City, where we explore his iconic portfolio and creative process.
The thing I say over and over again with Hopper is that he worked from the fact and he improvised, and those are his phrases for working from nature, direct observation, and using his imagination to meld all the things that he observed in reality into something bigger and more universal. Hopper had a very long association with the Whitney Museum that started as a very young man. He had his first exhibitions at the Whitney Studio Club, and he had a retrospective exhibition toward the end of his life. It was his wish that his artistic estate come to the Whitney Museum because of his long relationship to the museum. It included over 2,500 works, mostly drawings. And the drawings allow you to get inside his mind, I think, and to understand how he put together his iconic paintings and how he used drawings to work out those ideas. Where you get that the most is New York Movie, because you have all the drawings that were done in the theaters in New York, and you have all the drawings that were done in his studio that were the synthesis of that observed reality. The theater that it's most based on is the Palace Theater, and it was closed, but it was definitely not exactly. The floral pattern on the carpet, the gilt column, balcony underhangs, the backs of the chairs were probably pretty much like they were in the theater. But the space is different. The space becomes more compressed. Kind of things that add psychological tension. The lighting itself, that kind of thing was changed. This is a room that Hopper moved into in 1932. However, he'd lived in this building since 1913, and he died in either this room or the room next door in 1967. So this is the space where he painted many of his most famous paintings. Hopper loved to walk around New York. This was a great spot to do that from. A lot of the places that he painted are, in fact, not that far from here. That Hopper painted for Early Sunday Morning, the building that inspired it, was on 7th Avenue between 15th and 16th Streets. It's less than a mile from here. It was built in 1878 and torn down in 1938. So the important thing about that is that when Hopper painted it in 1930, it was already an old building. It evokes an old America. So he makes the painting about a kind of collective memory. Nighthawks was an amalgamation of three corners on Greenwich Avenue that meet at these wedge-shaped angles, and where you can sort of look through from one side of the building to the other in a kind of three-dimensional triangle. I also believe strongly that the tip of the Flatiron Building was probably the main inspirations for Nighthawks, because the shape is very, very similar, and it's in fact not that far from here. And that was typical of Hopper. He would cull from these different things and put them together. Those two paintings together are important because one shows an old New York and one shows a new New York kind of overtaking an old New York. A lot of Hopper's work is about downtown New York, and I think Hopper was aware of that kind of distance you get in an urban environment where you're physically close to people but you're not engaging with them. In New York, you can be walking down the street at night and see in someone's window, and you're the spectator looking in on these people, but it's like they can't see you, and it sets up a kind of voyeuristic tension that Hopper exploited over and over again. Hopper's paintings are intentionally awkward sometimes, or the figures are awkward, or there's a tension and a strangeness or a discomfort that is part of the subject matter of his paintings. But I think there's something also deeply sympathetic with the people that he's depicting and their condition. I would hope that seeing the paintings in tandem with the drawings and the carefulness that went into both allows people to understand him in a different way.
For information on the Edward Hopper Collection at the Whitney Museum, log on to whitney.org. Well, that's our show this week, friends. Visit WPBT2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. And be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. Until next time, I'm Kaylin James reminding you to stay creative. Thanks so much for watching. Bye.
Don't hate on me. It's Monday. Just gotta keep it up. Keep it up. Come on in here. Because otherwise I'm just gonna basically pass out. Safety! Nope, too. Yep. Okay, there we go. Pieces. It didn't start off well. I was gonna say by, I mean from, anyway. It was coming out of my mouth. My head already had the word from coming out. Created by the late artist of the same name. Created by the late artist of the same name. Ugh. Are you all right?
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity, and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.